Afternoon, everyone. It's time for the official start of the webinar and its recording. Welcome to the 6th of 12 AMOS webinars. My name is Mojca Baudaš. I come from the University of Ljubljana in Slovenia, where this session is hosted, and today I'll also act as a facilitator. Let me first explain for any newcomers that AMOS stands for the European Master in Official Statistics, a joint project of universities and data producers in the EU member states, EFTA, and EU candidate countries. The network that now comprises 23 master programs in 15 countries is expected to grow soon, as the third call for applications has been launched about a week ago. Now let me explain briefly how we run the webinar today. As a participant, you can watch and listen to the session. To interact with the presenters, you can use the chat window on the right, where many of you already said hello. Now we encourage you to use the chat window to pose questions throughout the webinar. The presenters will have several question breaks and they will respond during these breaks. Now, should you have any technical question, maybe, you know, apart from the sound issue, please try restarting the Adobe Connect or the computer. This usually solves all the problems. And now to the topic of today's webinar, big data. A hot topic also in official statistics, as in many other industries. I'm very happy to host two colleagues from Statistics Netherlands today, Pete and Marco. They will present themselves, so let's not waste any more time. Pete, Marco, please, the floor is yours.
Okay. Welcome, everybody. It's great to have you all online. It's a novel experience for us, so I hope everything goes well. I'll shortly introduce myself.
Oh. Use your video. Sorry.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I'm here.
Perfect.
Hello. Yeah. I'm Pete Daas. I'm a senior methodologist at Statistics Netherlands, and I'm one of the lead data scientists in our center of big data statistics.
Okay, my name is Marco Putz. Wait a minute, that's me. I'm a methodologist at CBS, also lead data scientist at CBDS, Center for Big Data Statistics. And yeah, the right of myself you can read here. Welcome at this webinar.
Yeah. Yeah, we have to switch mics occasionally. I'm going to give you an overview of what we will talk about in the webinar. We will briefly start by talking about the properties of big data. There have been definitions shown in the previous webinars, but we discuss what we consider typical properties of big data. And then we will focus on the use of big data in official statistics by looking at big data processes. I think we have enough experience now to try to sketch a general overview of how a big data process would look like. And it contains of the four phases shown here, and we will discuss them in a bit more detail. And then hopefully within 60 minutes we will be at the end of this webinar, and we can have a discussion. And in between topics, at certain points, we will have questions that you can answer. So what is big data? A lot of people are using that term and there are definitions, but when we look at the typical properties of big data, we see as the group we have, we asked ourselves the question, for what kind of data sources, with what kind of properties will people within our office come to us? And that gives an idea of what big data is composed of, and we see that big data is a source of data that is rapidly available. I think that's the most important property of big data at all. If big data wasn't rapidly available, I'm not sure if we would if we would use it. And because if it's rapidly available, it will be available in large amounts. It's generated in large amounts, so that's an important thing. It's often generated by population we don't know a lot of, so that makes it challenging. In our experience, such data sources often have poor quality metadata. There will be exceptions, of course, but we often have to deal with that. It usually has a low information content, so we're very happy that its data is available in large amounts. And because it has a low information content, it requires processing prior to use. And essentially, a lot of the things are related to the fact that you have no idea about the design of the data. My colleague Marco is nodding, so that should be okay. I think that's an important summary of the properties.
So, one of the most important things with big data is its size. And people always think that big data, because you're talking about size, that is only about the size. But one of the questions we started to ask ourselves is big data big because of the fact that it's a lot of data, or is there maybe another reason why big data is big? Why do we need so much data? So it was actually a cause or effect question. And in this slide, we try to depict this in the following way. At the horizontal axis, you see the amount of data which comes from sources expressed in bits. The vertical axis, you see the amount of data is needed to make statistics, also in expressed in bits. And when you look at, let's start with the survey data. When you look at it, you see that the amount of bits needed to make the statistics is about the same as the amount of bits in the sources. Why? You use stratification to make sure that your design is optimized for answering the question. So you ingest as large as possible data to actually make your statistics. But administrative data, that's already different. You are going to take the complete population, or the data for the complete population, and are going to make some statistics out of that. So the point is you have a much lower information density at the average, because of the fact you have a lot of bits getting in, but only a compressed part of the data is used to make the statistics. With big data, it's even worse. You have sources which have a lot of different information in there. There's really you cannot imagine all the information that is in there. For instance, when you look at Twitter, you see that there is a lot of information about all the topics you can imagine. So somehow you have to think about how to get the right data out. This also means that the density of the data is really, really low. And this means that when you want to answer a question based on big data sources like social media, you really have to ingest a lot of data to make sure that you can answer your questions. So the question is, yeah, is big data a cause or effect? When you look at it in this way, you see that it's much more an effect than that it's a cause. So the cause is much more the fact that you need a lot of data to be able to do something with it with big data sources. So this makes it actually quite difficult for us to make statistics because we were used to the fact that most of our data sources were actually tuned into the answering the questions that we had. Even when we are using administrative data, it's very close to the answers we want to give. But now we have a data set which, like we depicted here, looks like a duck sometimes and looks like a rabbit sometimes. Sometimes you need the rabbit and sometimes you need the duck. And answering questions in this data depends on how you look at the data. When you are looking, if you want to see, have information about the rabbit, you tune into the rabbit. If you want to have answer questions about the duck, you tune into the duck. So I like to explain it in this way. So then we come to our first question. So what sources do you consider as big data? We gave some options: social media messages, product prices on the websites, satellite pictures, tons of data of cows, persons registered in China, or activity tracker data of 8 persons. So please give your answers. We will give you 30 seconds to answer the question. I see that you are already busy answering the question very fast. So, and let's see what you think about it. Yeah.
Wow. Ah.
Yeah, I think that most people
it's
voted.
Enough. Yeah. Yep. Okay. That's it. Thank you for your answers. It's quite clear that the obvious choice of a lot of people are social media messages, and that's in essence true. For us, it's sort of the typical big data source. It contains every difficulty there is in the data source. It's a mixed population even, so it's quite challenging to use it. Other interesting thing is satellite pictures and sensor data of cows score in a similar way. Satellite pictures, I totally agree, also because it's a data source that has its images and it's extremely large, so it's a challenging area. Sensor data of cows, in our opinion, depends a bit on how much sensor you have. If I have the sensor data of cows in a one stable from a farmer, I don't consider it big data, but it's a very interesting set to start working with. But if you would have the data from all cows in the Netherlands, and there are 4 million of them in our country, that's a really challenge to deal with. And the same issue rises when you look at product prices on websites and activity tracker data of persons. If you only have a small set of data, then it's perfectly to use it for studies. But the real big data issues come when you have a large amount of data. And the persons register of China is a very interesting one because there are 1.4 billion people in China, but it's highly structured and I don't think it's available at a high frequency, but it's a clear administrative data source. But I also hope that this question makes clear that the boundary is sometimes quite difficult. Great, yeah. So we continue. Our focus in this webinar is how we can use big data. Big data has been discussed a lot in two previous webinars, and there were example shows. We want to discuss how it actually can be used, and we want to postulate a general view on big data processes and look at it from there on. When you look at the big data process in the terms of a generic statistical business process model, there are four phases that are very interesting for big data. The other phases shouldn't be considered because I'm not sure if they are applicable in this context. But the four phases that are important is the collect phase. You need to get data. That's quite challenging. You need to get access to data. Then you process the data. You check and convert the data in a second step. And then you do an analysis where you learn from and extract knowledge from data, and in the end you will disseminate your results. However, here we totally look on big data as the main source of input for official statistics. So we start from the fact that you will be creating a big data based official statistics. So big data is the main source. There are, however, alternative uses. For instance, if you have a survey and you would add big data as an additional source, then you don't have to adjust your paradigm that much, because you, if you use the big data as an additional source, your basis is still survey methodology. You could also use big data to impute missing data or as a calibration model. But the way we look at big data during this webinar is big data as the main source. That's a very important consideration. And if you look at that step, and you start with the big data that you have available, then you see that if you look at the four phases, the collect, the process, the analysis, and dissemination phase, that is a data-driven process that starts from the input and eventually you will hope will produce some output, and there are cycles in every stage. During the collection phase, you are looking at what is available. During the processing phase, you are converting data, and then you realize, oh, I need to add some additional metadata, or I need something else. So you return again to the collect phase, and the same is true after the processing phase. During analysis, you realize, oh, I should convert this variable value, and then you do the processing phase again and again, and in the end, when your first results come out, you probably discover something completely unexpected, and you need to check that again, and you need to check your process first. So it's a highly cycle phase because of the fact that you work in a data-driven way. It's different than what we are used to. It has a lot of cycles. And we will illustrate these phases by the examples. We know, of course, the work we've done on road intensity statistics, which is published. This uses road sensor data, numbers, number of vehicle counts. We also are doing quite interesting work on innovative companies, the innovative company statistics work, that work in progress, which is fairly close to becoming a better product. Here we analyze texts on the main page of a company website, where we try to determine if a company is innovative enough. So that's an interesting example because it doesn't use numbers, but it uses texts. And then we looked at another option is, yeah, do we have an example of pictures? And we, for the energy transition study, we are part of that study focuses on the detection of solar panels on pictures. We use aerial pictures, and that's another example we would like to illustrate our big data process with. And these are also three different types of data that can be used for, you know, studies. The first phase is the collect phase. It's a very important one because you have to assure that you have stable access to the data, which is challenging for big data sources because in a highly dynamic world, it's very important to have assure that you have long stable access to data, because you can create, if you want to create an official statistics that you can publish over a long time, and often the data you need is collected by private companies. I think the experience in the Netherlands we have in mobile phone companies is a typical example of that. It's very difficult to assure a constant data set that you can use. During this phase, it's also very important to keep in contact with those companies and try to get access to some data, because then you can try different approaches. Perhaps you have an idea in mind that you're going to use, so you could check various potential sources. But you can also apply a total different approach where you learn from the data by trial and error. So you just look at the data and then consider the possibilities. It's a challenging one to do that, but it's possible. It's very important at some point in time to include domain expert knowledge, but my personal experience here is that you shouldn't involve those experts too early, because they're highly focused on how we traditionally use the data, and that's something you don't want. But you really need their knowledge, because there's a lot of experience in those people. Ideas should come first. How did we solve that for three examples? The road sensor data was a very easy one, because that data is maintained by an organization that's paid by another governmental organization. And because the other governmental organization pays them, in principle, we have access to the data source via the Statistics Netherlands law. In that sense, it can be considered an administrative data source. So it's included in the law. That's nice. For websites of companies, we scrape the data for our studies because we are looking at it from a statistical perspective, and we try to not burden the website as much as possible. So we scrape it once, store the raw data, and do all the pre-processing after that. If we're going to use this data for official statistics, starting point, the idea we have at the moment is we always inform companies that we want to have scrape that data from their website, and we send them letters. But if we're going to use that in large amount, we have to find another way. Perhaps we can email them, and then we offer the option that they can opt out if they don't want to be if they don't want their data scraped from their websites. But then they will be burdened in another way, or we allow to phone them or send them a survey. For the solar panel work at the moment, we have free access to area pictures that are updated once a year. Depending on our findings, we wonder if that is frequent enough. That brings us to the second question. What is the biggest problem when you're dealing with when you're creating a statistics fully based on big data? The stability of the source? Yeah, you can answer the questions. The stability of the source, stability of access, stability of the population, all of the above, or are there no problems at all?
Yeah, okay.
Very interesting to see all the activity of people. Oh. I think this question is too easy. Yep. Okay, I'm ending the poll now. It's great to see all the answers. I think the obvious answer is all of the above. The stability of the source can be a problem, certainly when it's from a commercial company. They might change it much more rapidly than we are used to. Administrative sources also change, but these sources might change much more. Stability of access is also an issue. Usually commercial companies start to let people, organizations pay for data. That's a policy we don't have. We do pay them, but that's only for the amount of time they spend in, for instance, copying the data source or something like that. Stability of the population is also an issue. It might be quite dynamic. However, that depends on the data source. But for instance, for mobile phone data or social media is another example. It's clear that people are not always using the phone from the same company, and that activity on social media might change rapidly as well. It's nice to see that two people think there are no problems at all. I wonder. Thank you for your answers. I will continue on the next topic. That's the second phase of the process, the processing phase, and that's in principle composed certainly of at least of two steps, where you do some pre-processing. But this also contains some initial checks, certainly because of the large amount of data you need to include some efficient initial checks. In the pre-processing phase, you convert and adjust the data prior to use, and it may involve certainly in the beginning visualizations to get an idea of what's going on. After pre-processing, there might be a need for cleaning. That's also known as editing. Marco will explain that. It's about cleaning the data when you discover that the quality for a specific use is not sufficient. Because of the large amounts, it should be fully automatic. Manual checks will certainly limit. Will cost too much time in this case. And this may also involve visualizations. So let's look at the pre-processing. What you do is pre-process raw data. There are in principle two options to do that. You can either do that after receiving it in the office in a secure way, depending on the privacy issues with the data. And we use that approach for automatic information system data. That's in principle the GPS signal of ships. We also do that for aerial images. And of course, we do this for web scraping, where we own full control. Downside of doing pre-processing after receiving it is maybe that the data set can be quite large, so that's it may be an effort to copy the data, and it also has high infrastructural needs inside the office for particular data sources. I think the AIS data is an example of that. The other approach, which we apply in two cases, is do the pre-processing according to our specification at the location of the data maintainer. We do that for the road sensor data, but also for mobile phone data. Here we use the infrastructure of the data maintainer, which has the advantage, which is the general big data principle, try to keep the data where it is and run the code or the pre-processing step in the database or the whatever IT infrastructure you have to do the pre-processing. The additional advantage is that essentially a smaller data set will be transferred, which will be according to the needs we have. It may also solve privacy issues. That's one of the reasons why we do that for mobile phone data at the data maintainer, because we don't have non-privacy sensitive data. And yeah, people have to realize that even though you do the pre-processing at the location of the data maintainer, the process chain is still in control of the NSI, or should be in control of the NSI. Essential reason why you do pre-processing is increase the information content of the big data source, and you can do that by either removing stuff, such as unneeded and clearly erroneous records. For instance, it reduce the size in the population. If you are able to if you discover that your big data source contains a mixed population and you're only interested in one, you should try to remove the other one as soon as possible. It remove unneeded and clearly erroneous values. If a variable is not of interest, but that's something usually discovered during analysis and in the next step of the processing stage, you can delete the column. Only keep what is really needed. It might be the case that the big data source you have is composed of event-based data. For instance, a data set with transport data from electronic chip cards, where the check-in and check-out location of is included. We have that in the Netherlands, and it's the other example is the Oyster card in the UK. You might want to convert that prior to studies by converting the check-in and check-out location to the trips of the individuals. So that's a more unit-oriented one. You could even do more advanced stuff on that, so tailor the data to the needs of the NSI. You might even convert particular values to the ranges used by the NSI all to make sure that you can use it as much as possible. And the other important thing is you can also add features, extract features from the data that's available, and in principle you're constructing new variables. I'm sorry. For text, pre-processing is extremely important, and you often try the effect of different choices. So you do this a lot. Should I remove stop words or not? Should I do stemming or not? But in the example, because of the huge experience we have on road sensor data, we will discuss this topic on our next slide. During that pre-processing and during the process phase in general, it's very important to look at the populations included in the data source and the variables that are in there. It's very important to do that, because sometimes the units included in the source, you want to know which ones there are, because you have no idea of the design. So can you identify them? It's one of the topics we spend a lot of time on this in our office, but if we would include this in this webinar, I would certainly it would certainly take half an hour to explain that. But what in principle we are learning is how to extract particular features related to background characteristic of the unit, so we are able to identify particular groups of units and decide if they can be included or not. For instance, we can separate in social media people versus companies, and within the group of people we can see who are women and who are men. The other thing you have to look at is in the variable, how is the correspondence between the definition used in the data maintainer source and the NSI? That's in a sense definition alignment. You have to check that, but that's a topic very familiar to us. That's something we also do with administrative data, although the differences between the definitions of those variables might be quite similar. So let's discuss an example. For the road sensor data. The data we have is data generated by 20,000 road sensors in the Netherlands. We are a small country, but we have a huge amount of sensors. And these are only the sensors on the highway. A perfectly working sensor would produce every minute a data set, a data record containing the number of vehicles detected during that minute. So a perfectly working sensor would produce 1440 records per day. That's quite a lot. Every record contains, in the data set we have, 14.8 variables, but we only needed 13, but that's something we discovered when we were at the end of the entire process cycle. So we did a lot of redoing stuff in that area. Some records are clearly erroneous, so they can be deleted. We have minus one vehicles, for instance. That's impossible. Sometimes you have no measurement at all. That's something you don't need. Some records have clearly an error flag on, which is already an indication there's something wrong. Location is not on the road, and with that I mean we had sensors that were very active counting vehicles in the North Sea, and we even had a sensor in Germany, which is not in the Netherlands. So that's something you can check and correct. This is an example of a road sensor, because you could decide I'm just including a particular subset of road sensors, but if you look at a single road sensor, and this is a plot of the number of vehicles detected by a single road sensor during 196 days, you can see that the quality of those plots vary a lot. Sometimes they have a very nice profiles. The first two are from the Saturday and the Sunday, and the subsequent five are from the weekdays when people are working, and then again an additional week starts. But sometimes you then don't have no signal at all. So what we want to do is, what we've done here is developed quality indicators that can be implemented very fast and that can be used to decide if a sensor on a particular day should be included or not. And it's quite clear that in the example shown here, there are particular days when you don't want the data from this sensor, and you can use data from another sensor here. So we implemented quality indicators. Oh, no animation. We actually implemented five, but the first two are important in the example here. And those quality indicators can be extremely simple. A good sensor, a sensor that works, produces data every minute of the day, will have a particular number of measurements that's very high, 1440 in this case. So the number of measurements by a sensor on a single day is an indication of its quality. And the other important thing is the data that's missing is that occasionally missing. So it's short missing values, or is that a long period in which you are missing a lot of data, which produces a large block. And we developed a block indicator for that to give an idea on the size of the blocks for which data is missing. The other indicators will come up later. Ah, sorry. If you make a plot of that, of the number of measurements for a set of 120 million sensors, where you plot the number of measurements versus the size of the block indicator, you get a very interesting slide. On the right bottom, there are perfectly working sensors, so they certainly should be included in our be used for our statistics. But if the number of measurements is decreasing, then depending on the distribution of those missing values, you might decide to either include or exclude them. On the top, the higher the value, the larger the block is. And the line, the curved line that goes up, is the value of sensors that miss all the data sets in a single, all the data in a single block. But the downside of this picture is, this plot is that it gives a sort of a bad impression that quite a large amount of data is poor, but that's because a lot of the good working sensors are on the right bottom side. And if you make a 3D plot of that, out of that, so you count the number of sensors that are included on each position on this plot, then you can see a huge peak on the bottom right, and that indicates that certainly more than 85% of all the sensors is working quite well. So that's a good thing. No, sorry, the x-axis is the number of measurements, so the for a sensor, so it goes from 0 to 1440, and the y is the b, the block value, so the size, the value that indicates the number of missing values.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's quite a challenging plot to look at. But in principle, everything that's on the bottom right is quite good. But if you're missing, for instance, if you're missing half of the values that might be occasionally missing, so you have a measurement and then you don't have a measurement and then you have a measurement again, that's okay. But it might also be that you miss half of the day, so you miss an entire set, and then the block size is extremely large. And those combination of values is used to decide if a sensor is good enough to be included in the next process.
Thank you.
So we are right on track of the quality. This is also something we can discuss at the end of this webinar. So what is a good quality in the sense of big data? What are the advantages in this relation? So you can think about this question, what the advantages are of big data in the context of good quality. And I suggest that you start chatting your ideas now. Think
yes,
about
so
it.
At the moment, some people are experiencing problems. So, but let's now use the chat to try to answer this question. It's a tough question, Pete.
Okay. I'm starting
what
to...
What are the advantages of big data in this
what?
Context?
Okay.
Nobody wants
okay.
to wants
yeah.
to expose any good things.
Yeah. Well, maybe I can give our answers.
Okay.
So I took over, Marco here. So what is good quality? It's actually a trick question because when you look at big data, a lot of these big data sources, as you already saw, have a lot of problems with them. So when you are going to define a good quality big data source, yeah, it's really hard to say what is good quality when there is a lot of overlap in the data. Like I already showed in my my plot, there is a lot of overlap in the data, so you can always find some other part of the data where some information isn't. So yeah, good quality is really hard to define, and that's also the reason why I'm always talking about the fact that we really have to rethink the way we talk about quality in the context of big data when you are looking at quality for official statistics. What are the advantages of big data in this context? Well, the advantage I also already said, when some part of the data is bad, missing, bad quality or whatever, there is always somewhere some data which you can use instead of the data that has a bad quality. So because of the overlap in the data, you always find something. So I also see now that there is something, an answer coming in, if the data combines the sample statistics. I think at the moment that you do something like that, you will throw out a lot of data. The point is, when you look at sample statistics, the data should be really, really neat. There should be no mistake in the data. Why? It's quite easy. You have a weighing factor, which can be quite high for a certain stratum. And at the moment that you that weighing factor is quite high, and there is a mistake in the data, you have a bias immediately. One of the nice examples that I use is what happens when Bill Gates is in some statistics in the United States, in the sample, in statistics in the United States. You really will have a great bias at that moment. So I think for big data, the quality concerns are different than for other data sources. So, okay, we continue now. So data cleaning, like I already said, it's really hard to say what a good quality is, and we define some quality indicators, but still we have to clean the data. And by the way, why I'm talking about cleaning data and not about editing data, when you edit data, you have rules which you define when data is bad, and you are going to apply these rules by editing the data. So for me, it's more a semantic problem that I have with the term data editing. It's much more like data cleaning. And why do you clean the data? Well, like we already said, many of the data sources are very noisy. And the point is, when you want to do analysis with big data sources, you want to know one part of the data, what is the correlation with another part of the data, or whatever. When you are going to do that on really noisy data, and the noise is not correlated, that's actually the definition of the noise, then the correlation is going really down, so you cannot do some real good analysis because of the noise. I demonstrated this with a piece of R code. I'm not an R programmer, you can see that because I'm using is signs instead of arrows. When you run this, you have a very clear signal X, you have noisy signals Y1 and Y2, and the thing is, there is only a correlation of 0.6 in this example. So your data is really, your analysis is really sensitive to the to the noisy signals. And another point is, erroneous data will have a negative effect on the quality of your estimate. So you have to do something of data cleaning. So first, what is noise? I'm using the term noise a lot of times now. So first, let me define what noise is. Like I said, when you look, for instance, at social media messages, in the data, there is a lot of different information there. People are talking about the weather, are talking about the money, are talking about anything. So there is a lot of information in there. So somehow you have to tune in the right information. And when you found out how to tune in the information, then all the data which is perpendicular to the noise, to the information, is actually noise. So everything we define as noise is that part of the data which is not giving us any information about the question in, we have to answer. So like I already suggested, we are talking about data signals, noise. So I like to compare the data cleaning process with big data as a signal filtering. So we have an input data that comes in. We have an automatic cleaning process, which you can describe as a filter, and you have a signal coming out, a cleaner signal which comes out. And the only thing you have to do is manually tweak on your parameters, your process parameters, to make sure that you don't throw away too much or that your signal is corrupted by your data editing. So when we go back to the road sensor data, because of the fact that we have already a process running on that statistics, then and you start looking from that perspective to the data, you see that we have counts per minute of vehicles, which means that we have 1,440 counts per day. We have arrivals of vehicles at a road sensor, and because of the fact that we are dealing with arrival times, you can say we are talking about a Poisson process. And it's going really crowded, getting really crowded on the road. The Poisson process will not be valid anymore. And we are talking about a semi-Poisson process. And when you look at it again at the quality indicators, we already looked at the first quality indicators. When you look at Other quality indicators which the filter should have is which the filter should add to the data. It's actually the smoothness of the signal, the YAS indicator I show here in this slide, but also the D indicator. It's the difference between the data and the signal, where I have to say that the difference between data and signal means actually bias. So we want to have as less as possible bias as a result of cleaning the data, and we want to have a smoother signal. So that's the main point. We do that with the traffic loop data by using recursive Bayesian estimator, where we say that the individual measurements are actually drawn out of a Poisson distribution, and we have a hidden state, a hidden variable, which actually has say something like an average intensity on the road for each and every minute. So we are estimating a hidden state based on the real data. And the nice thing when you do something like this is that at the moment that the data point is missing, because of the fact that you are using a recursive Bayesian estimator, you also have your prediction still from X3 given X2 in this case. So you don't have any missing data anymore. You actually have an estimation of it. This is actually getting better at the moment that you add a smoothing step. And when you look at the resulting data then, this is the result of the raw data from one road sensor. It's actually the one on the 1st of January. That's why you see a little peak at minute zero. So when you look at it, that when the intensity increases, the bandwidth of all the measurements also increases. So furthermore, you see, so on the horizontal axis we have time, vertical axis we have intensity. What you also see is that a lot of data is missing. These are all the -1 points at the lower part. And for a lot of data editing procedures, it's really hard to make something from this data. We tried it, also other parties tried to do it, but you always have a lot of problems with biases. And so when we use this filter, which we developed for the road sensor data, we put that over the data, you see that the data is much smoother. Not really smooth, but it's really a lot smoother, which means that we can actually do some correlations between sensors. And furthermore, you also see that it is quite agnostic for the missing data, the signal which comes out. So, which means that we really can do something with that data, and we can really use this to do some estimation. By the way, we also looked at the bias, and the bias is really almost zero. It was 0.01% or something like that. Another example are the solar panels, and with the solar panels we were having already a problem with the pre-processing, because we are using aerial pictures for that, which are higher resolution pictures, higher resolution than actually satellite images. And the problem is that you have to figure out where the houses are. So what we started to do first is based on the register we already have about the polygons of each and every house, we just cut out all the rooftops of the houses. That you see at the right side of this slide. And then your real analysis of the data can start, your real detection of the solar panels, and we use deep learning for that. This is still work in progress. We use deep learning to actually locate the solar panels on the rooftops, and in this way we can count the number of solar panels in the Netherlands. So then we come to the third phase, the analyze phase, and this is actually the phase where you get insights from the data, and this can be insights during your research phase, but that can also be the phase where you actually create some aggregates and start to do something with the data. So you can do that in two ways. First of all, you can have a data-driven way, which we prefer normally, because you don't have any assumptions. But this is only possible when your source is complete, doesn't have any errors in it, you can really say that you have a complete population is represented. In most cases, however, you still have you cannot fulfill this assumption. So you have to use a model-driven approach. For the road sensor, we did that. We used a model-driven approach. Why? Because our target population, our frame, was not the sensor itself. And in this slide, we try to compare a normal survey on a normal social economic survey with the traffic statistics we made out of the road sensor data. So as a frame, we don't have to, we cannot use road sensors. We actually have the roads which tell us something about the number of road stretches which are accounted by a certain loop. So our unit is also kilometers. It's not the number of sensors, the number of vehicles in the frame. No, it's the number of kilometers. In the selection phase, with the sample statistics, we have a design which samples the persons out of the population. With road sensors, we already had a selection with the roads, and these are the road sensors. So the road sensors are selected for us. Then we have the measurement itself. In a survey statistics, these are questionnaires. With the road sensor data, these are actually sensor data, so measurements of the sensors. So then the most important part from this slide is the line at the lower end, which are actually the weights. With a survey statistics, these are based on demographics. In our traffic statistics, it's based on the location, on which road they are located, and which position on that road the traffic loops are located. So we start with creating a frame based on the road network, and you see a piece of road network, and you see that it's already quite complex. There are a lot of intersections here, and on off ramps, and there are actually four roads already here in this small part of the Netherlands. And when you plot all the loops on that, all the traffic sensors on that, you see it's even getting worse. I mean, you have traffic loops almost everywhere, and it's actually really hard to figure out what kind of information it gives, especially on the intersections itself. So I just have a smaller impression here. The goal is actually to simplify the picture. First of all, to make sure that all the sensors are placed on the road, because also the locations of the sensors are quite noisy, as you see here. And second, to actually say something about the roads we are interested in. And these are the main routes, the green roads that are here. So we have to go for a raw shape, like on the left side, to the main route on the right side. We also have to project the points. We have to look at the entrance and exit ramps. And if we have done that, we can actually segment all the road network to the different road sensors. And at the end, when you did that, when you determined the segments which you need, based on the location of the road sensors and on off ramps, the final estimate made in vehicle kilometers is just the inner product between the length of the segments and the count of the vehicles. And this is actually something that is really much alike a Horvath-Thompson estimator. So now it's turn for Pete again.
Yes. When you have enough data, you can really use a data-driven approach, and then the majority of the data contains really information you need. But sometimes, and that sometimes happens quite often with the big data sources we study, is that only a part of the data that you eventually have is composed of records of interest, and that amount may vary a lot. It can be between 50 and 1%, for example. And I'm showing a few examples here of all the company websites we scraped to look at innovative companies. We found that 9% of them was innovative. That's a small set. For the social tension indicator, where we study social media to look at messages containing words related to social tension, this is actually a rare event, so it doesn't occur that much. When you look at different units active on social media, for instance persons versus companies, we found that company accounts only account for 3% of the data that you have. And when you're studying the language written in Dutch on a particular text, then you discover that not everybody, not only people in the Netherlands write in Dutch, but also people living in the upper part of Belgium write Dutch, and you will want to remove them from the data set because we're studying the Dutch population. And those are actually 80% who were identified as Belgian because of the particular words they use. So this is essentially all about modeling, but also all about modeling and imbalance. Data set and dealing with that imbalance in your data set. That's quite challenging. The approach we have, and I'm looking here at dealing an imbalanced data set from the perspective of a classification problem. What we actually do is we draw a sample from the large data set, manually classify them, preferably 1,000 or more. We do that with multiple persons with clear instructions, and we look at the results between the different persons, and this is our training and test set. And then we try various approaches, various ways of creating a model and see what works best. It can be very traditional statistical approaches like logistic regression, but it can also be more advanced new machine learning stuff such as random forest, support vector machines and neural networks. And we just see what works best, approach best suits our problem. We try to add features as much as possible because we really found out that this works really well because it adds domain knowledge. So it improves your models. You need to check certainly when dealing with text the effects of pre-processing steps. Any choices you made in the beginning may negatively affect the model you have, so you try a lot. And sometimes over or under sampling may work. Really depends on the problem. We have positive and we have a negative approach of that, and we try to create visualizations wherever possible because it helps to interpret our findings, and it's usually another way of looking at the data set you have. For instance, when you look at innovative companies, we had the advantage here that we could use the data collected by a survey. We have a biannual survey for companies for innovative statistics. And we draw a sample of 3,000 companies of which we were, which was clear that they were innovative, and we added 3,000 non-innovative companies. The downside of this is that we only sent that questionnaire to companies with 10 or more working persons. And the reason why we were looking at this data and looking at innovation is because we were interested in small companies. So that's something we realized in the beginning. Then we scraped the websites of those 6,000 companies. We did language detection. We removed subwords and stemming. All worked perfectly. We looked at the words. We looked at the words on their own. Combinations of two words, combination of three words, and word embeddings, which is a way of looking at the words in the context of other words. And unigrams and word embeddings work really well. And then we also added some features. We didn't have a lot of features, but language was an important one. Websites in the Netherlands can also be in English, which is a bit more associated with innovation. Looked at the URLs on a website, if there were email addresses, and if there were phone numbers and addresses, and the last two didn't really contribute a lot. We tried different approaches, and logistic regression worked really well in this context. which has the advantage that you have an interpretable model. You can look at the combination of words, or particular words that are used. And we were very pleased with the results. However, we realized that we created this model based on testing analysis data. So for larger companies. So we tested this model on two other data sources. In the Netherlands, there's an annual Innovation Top 100 for the small and medium enterprises. We looked at those results, and a lot of those companies included in those lists were identified as innovative, but not all. There's a clear difference in the definition here. For instance, there were holiday houses, companies that rent out holiday houses that were indicated by the Dutch SME Innovation Top 100 as innovative, but not according to our model, which we think is a good thing. And we also looked at a lot of Dutch startups. We applied our model on a huge list of them, and the majority of them, nearly all of them, were identified as innovations. So we really think we have a very interesting approach to detect if a company is innovative based on the text of their website. And we also realized that the definition we use is more focused on technological innovation. We tried this on 1 million company websites in the Netherlands, and we created detailed maps. And this also is a way of seeing how our model works. Is there anything curious going on? And this map allowed us to create very detailed pictures on the 4-digit zip code level of the Netherlands where innovative companies are found. And according to our model at the moment, we think 9% of those companies are innovative, but you have to do some initial checks still, because it's a very interesting value. And then we come to question 4. Great, yeah, we're really speeding things up here. Could you name a few ways of dealing with imbalanced data sets when using modeling? That could be undersampling negative cases, add more positive cases, change evaluation metrics, or cross-validate, and you have multiple options.
Okay, let's wait for the votes, and then we'll just stop for a few seconds to stop and restart recording. It's just a technical issue.
De video moet als video gestart worden. So I think we can restart the video now because nothing changes in the. Okay. So when you look at the results, it's really clear. Change evaluation matrix is really a good one. Yeah, and there are a lot of evaluation metrics, and it's actually very good to look at this. Well done, people. And now I have to get rid of this one. So how can I get rid of it? Okay, yeah. So the last part is the dissemination, and actually it's really short because of the fact that we found out that we have some animations there, but the best thing to do is look at the animations at our website. So with dissemination, like with the complete process, like you already saw, the process with big data really resembles a lot of the processes we have running in official statistics. And also for the dissemination, this is really true, very much resembles standard output that we make for official statistics, within official statistics. There is actually one point where it is different, and it's in the visualization part. It's really important for big data because of the fact that you have really a lot of data which you have to visualize on a micro level. It needs some new challenges. One of the results we did on that point are the dot maps. The other one is that you also have to do some stop storytelling, and that's what we did with the AIS journey. So the dot maps, you can find it on the research website of CBS, of Statistics Netherlands, using the link at the lower end. It's actually a commuting visualization. When you zoom in completely, each dot represents one person, not at the place where he lives, but somewhere in the neighborhood. And you see what distance that person has to travel to get to work. And when you zoom out, like the picture is right here, you actually get an impression of how much people have to travel in different parts of the country. So so it's actually a visualization which aggregates the data dynamically, and I really would suggest that you have a look at the website of Statistics Netherlands to interact with the data there. The other one is a more storytelling part, where we wanted to show how big ships, big vessels, sea vessels, which come from China, how the containers are distributed over Europe, because what they do is they use even bigger container giants to get the containers to Europe, and which means that we get a bigger and bigger logistic problem around Europe when it comes to distributing all the containers through Europe. So the containers, most of the containers arrive at the port of Rotterdam, at the second Maasvlakte, and are then redistributed to throughout the rest of Europe. And this animation is much more a storytelling animation visualization. And I see there is no link at the below, but I know for sure that in the PDF file, which you can download, you can there it is. Yeah, here you see the link to the to this visualization. So I would suggest you have a look at both visualizations, and then you see one storytelling based on big data and one where we try to visualize all the data that we have available. So this ends our presentation. We would like to thank you for your attention. And if there are any questions, I think we are willing to answer them. I think we also have time for that. So. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. We already have two questions that popped up during your talk. First of all, the software. What do you use for pre-processing and further on?
Yeah, okay. Most of the time we are using R and Python for pre-processing. Actually, there is a difference between Pete and me. Pete likes to use R. I like to use Python. Furthermore, we also use Spark when it's for the AIS data. We use Spark for doing the processing of the data. So these are actually the tastes we use. In the beginning, I also used C, but people don't like to use C anymore in this these modern times. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One thing we have to mention is performance issues, Pete told me. What you really have to make sure is that the tool you are using has enough performance to actually do the job, because the road sensor data, I started processing it with R code, and R was really not suited for that job at that moment. So. That's the reason why I also switched to Python at that moment. So you really have to make sure that the tool you use performs well, and parallelization in all the tools is really necessary to make sure that everything is processed within a short time. Yes. Now I'm ready.
Okay. There was a very early question. Can you give us an example of how to access an easily available big data source on the internet? And what tools would you need to access such a source? Do you have an example?
Okay.
So that I guess that people would like to try it out before doing it for real.
There are several ways to access big data. One of the ways we do it is because of the fact that the big data is available within one of the governmental departments. So at that moment we have free access to the data, and there's always a hassle to figure out how to get the data here. I prefer just to use something like FTP or something like that to receive the data at that moment. But a lot of those agencies like it when the data is sent by disk. So that's still one of the things, but it's not really necessary anymore. When you're talking about a couple of terabytes of data, you can use several nights to just send the data from one department to the other. So that's not the problem anymore. When it comes to other data, you can use APIs. The aerial photos we receive by an API, so we just query and the database over there. Also, web scraping is one of the options we use a lot. So web scraping websites. There are several options. I prefer the API option because of the fact that you have the freedom just to do it, and it's simplified when you compare it to using web scraping. But in some cases you cannot do anything else than web scraping, so you have to do it then. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. How big data is applied? How is big data applied in online surveys? Do you have any experience in that, and any advantages and disadvantages?
So it's meant with by using survey data. So combining big data with survey data.
Well, the question doesn't specify that. Just
so, and that's a question.
Online surveys. So maybe ideas how to use this. How to use big data in that context.
Yeah, there is a paper by Jan van de Brakel and P. Das and some other people which is dealing with that point. The point is normally that big data is much more high frequent a lot of times. Surveys are much more low frequent, so you have to combine a high frequent data source with a low frequent survey data source. And what Jan van de Brakel is using is a state-based model for that, where he feeds in the high-frequency data to the low-frequency, parallel to the low-frequency survey data, and that works quite well. But there are actually at this moment there is there's one PhD student at the University of Maastricht working on that subject, and another PhD student will also look at. At stuff like that, so also at the University of Maastricht, so, okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have one question from France. What about tests in big data context?
Testing the models. What we actually do is using three data sets, test set, validation set, and of course a training set. The point is that your validation set and your test set are your validation set and your training set are actually both used for training your model, and that's the reason why you have to put some data aside, and you also have to make sure that your model will stay valid. So you have to repeat some way of validation in the future. So. So these are two parts of the answer. Once you have created the model, you validate it by another data set which is not used when training it. Okay. I didn't...
I don't know how to answer that. Okay. This is Pete here. Actually, for the innovative companies, We use the set of 1 million companies to see how well our model performs, and we have no idea at the moment if the 9% we found is extremely high or low. But you can imagine you have a set of 1,000 on which you train and test the model, but you have a set of 1 million now on which you apply the model, and there might be specific cases that are scored innovative, even if they're not. But the results from our training and test set seems to suggest that our model is extremely well working, and we don't have any false positives. But if you're going to throw it at 1 million websites, a lot of things might go on, and we test that as well. And there we try different approaches. Usually zoom in a specific region and check if everything is okay. And because I'm familiar with the city of Eindhoven, I'm currently looking at the findings of that model, and they seem to suggest that everything looks quite okay. So, good question.
Okay, do you use some heuristics to process all that volume of data?
That's a question for Marco.
We are switching a lot because we found out that my microphone is not working quite well. So, when you use machine learning algorithms, you are using heuristics by definition. Another part is when you look at the road sensor data, we use some heuristics because of the fact that we made some assumptions about how the data looks like. So, there are some heuristics that guide into the right direction of the answer. But you have to be careful that this will not lead to assumptions which are not true. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have one more question about open software. So are you using open software? I'm not sure if this came a little bit earlier when we already, as we already spoke about the software, so maybe...
Yes, we use a lot of open software. We don't use that much commercial software, not to say that we are not using any commercial software. So Hadoop and Spark are both part of the Apache software, so it's open source. Also Python and all the modules we use are open software. And of course R with CRAN is also open software, so we only use open software. Yeah. Also because of the fact that there is a big community behind it. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what about the use of mobile phone data for statistics, tourism or mobility statistics? Any experience in CBS?
Yeah, we had a study a couple of years ago with one of the phone companies. We did actually did some calculations of daytime populations, and these were quite successful, but we were afraid to publish them at that moment. We are now working with another phone company, which gives us also the possibility to develop our own process, like Pete was talking about the process chain. So we are developing our process, which will be part of the process chain for using the data at the mobile phone company. And I think that's a much more successful way of dealing with it. We're also learning a lot about mobile phones and how they register to different antennas at this moment. So one of the things is don't underestimate the number of the knowledge you need as a data scientist to use a data source. It's really important that you start using the data yourself and you start to figure out how the data works and how it can be used. So don't underestimate the domain knowledge you need for using for being a data scientist in the field of official statistics. Yes.
Okay, from Switzerland, we have this question. They say that the one issue that they currently have is the interpretability of the algorithms used. They can get good results with advanced algorithms, but it is difficult or impossible to know why the algorithm came up with certain results.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned that you have good experience with the interpretability of logarithmic regressions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I will give a part of the answer and Pete will give the second part of the answer because we both have experience with that. Me and my colleague Tim de Jong, we are working on deep learning. And what we found out there is that the hyperparameters you can change within your model change a lot in the performance of your resulting network. And most of the time you are actually tweaking around with your model, and you are changing a lot of parameters, and you're searching in the hyperparameter space which parameters function best for your problem. And it is a hassle, and the only thing you can do to make it more workable is to make sure that you have much more compute power to use it. So so that's the first part of the answer. And I think about the about the logar the regression, Pete will give an answer. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting question. What we usually try in the end of the process chain when we have to develop a model, that we try different approaches, and somehow I'm usually focused on classification. And we have very good experience with logistic regression in that area. And the advantage is that certainly when you look at text, because I'm applying it a lot to text, you can really see which words or combination of words are included in the model and what's the weight assigned to it. And that makes it good interpretable, and that's what usually a lot of people where we work for prefer. However, depending on the position in the chain, for instance, if we are using texts and we want to remove the people from the upper part of Belgium because they don't belong to the population we are studying, we have a support vector machine based model for that that identifies words typically for Dutch, typically for Belgian people. And at that position in the chain, a lot of our customers or internal clients don't bother the fact that we use a support vector machine there. The only discussion is when we use an approach at the end, when we have a model at the end of the chain, then the discussion starts about interpretability or not. And fortunately, logistic regression works well, but for instance, if deep learning would be much better than all the other ones, then it would be interesting to see, because a lot of people say, yeah, then you have a black box and you don't know what you're doing, but you can feed a model with typical cases and see how it reacts, so you can at least study it from the outside, see what's going on. Mark was nodding, I'm giving the right answer here. So.
Okay, and now that you're talking about the tech, there was one more question. Are there any examples of big data applied to qualitative information collected on internet?
Okay. I don't. Marco is nodding, so I'm going to give the microphone to him.
Okay.
We have an example, and it's actually an example we did together with some more social statistics. We did a study on a very. Oh wait, I have to show my face. Yeah. We did a study with. we did a study in a very small area in the Netherlands, Roos aan de Maas, which was actually in a qualitative study. And what people wanted to know there, what is the social capital in Roos aan de Maas, which is really a qualitative question. And we had really a lot of problems in operationalizing that question. We came up with some network analysis to make sure that you see the interactions within an area. We came up with identifying typical things people are talking about. We have some experience, but yeah, I don't know if there are really good experiences because we try to we really try to get a little bit more. Yeah, we like to have much more concrete results, and that was really hard in that study. So so I think there is a lot of work to do in these kinds of qualitative studies still. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and we are running very late, but one last mm-hmm. question. What is the next step to standardize the use of big data in statistical offices?
Okay, standardization means that we have to look at processes, and we started to look at processes like we showed here in this presentation. So that's the first step. The second step is actually about methodology and quality. And of course IT. So You need a good IT infrastructure. You need to discuss which kind of tools you are using. And since big data is still a quite new topic, you also still see that the tools are actually changing in time. So that's actually one of the problems when you want to standardize. We now decided on Spark, but in 5 years, maybe we will use another tool. The quality part is that we like to think in quality frameworks within statistical offices. And as you already saw, the quality of big data sources, when you look at the big data source per se, just at the data itself, then you cannot really get a grip on the quality quality part. So it's also too early to work on a quality framework. One of the PhD students I was mentioning at the University of Maastricht will also have a look at the quality of big data. So there will come something out. The third part, the methodological part, some methodologists think that we already have all the methods. But what you see here is that statistics, methodology within statistics, is going to be broader. For instance, econometrics needs new techniques because of the fact that we only focus now on smaller data sets. Now we have big data sets, which has a data deluge, actually. And we have to use other techniques, other methods, to actually do something with that data. For standardizing, we need other methods. We need a bigger methodological toolbox. We need some more ideas about how to define the quality of big data, which does not only look at the data per se. And third of all, we need to decide on an IT infrastructure. We decided on Spark, but that could be another one in a couple of years. Yes.
Okay. Thank you both for this insightful lecture. Very interesting. And we took 10 more minutes because we thought it is very important that people get feedback. Many thanks to our participants who joined us today from so many different places and for all the questions that you posed to presenters. Now, if you wish to download the presentation, it will be available in a few seconds. In the meantime, I'd kindly ask you to check your inbox and please answer our short survey. The next webinar is scheduled for Wednesday, 4th of April, when Eva Andres and Thomas Augustin from the University of Munich will be presenting how to integrate information from different data files. It's an introduction to statistical matching. So we'll leave now the room open for another 10 minutes or so, and we'll also publish the link to the recording by the end of the week at the latest on the webinar website. Thank you all for now and have a nice evening. Bye-bye.
Have a nice evening.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.